Recorded Books presents An Unabridged Recording of The Road by Cormac McCarthy, narrated by Tom Stechschulte, and directed by Lynn Flanagan. This book is copyrighted 2006 by M71 Limited. This recording is copyrighted 2006 by Recorded Books. Cormac McCarthy was born in Rhode Island in 1933, but spent most of his childhood near Knoxville, Tennessee. After studying liberal arts at the University of Tennessee, he served with the U.S. Air Force for 4 years. Upon return to civilian life, he spent 2 more years studying, but dropped out of college to pursue his writing. While widespread public recognition came comparatively late to McCarthy, he has long been considered one of America's foremost novelists by his peers. In 1976, he moved to El Paso, Texas, where he lives today, and his fiction throughout his life has paralleled this move from the southeast to the west. With The Road, McCarthy now explores a post-apocalyptic world that indelibly bears some of his vintage trademarks: a man and his young son, a blasted American landscape, and sparse prose that is at once both brutal and tender. And now, The Road.
When he woke in the woods in the dark and the cold of the night, he'd reach out to touch the child sleeping beside him. Nights dark beyond darkness, and the days more gray each one than what had gone before. Like the onset of some cold glaucoma dimming away the world. His hand rose and fell softly with each precious breath. He pushed away the plastic tarpaulin and raised himself in the stinking robes and blankets and looked toward the east for any light, but there was none. In the dream from which he'd wakened, he'd wandered in a cave where the child led him by the hand, their light playing over the wet flowstone walls, like pilgrims in a fable swallowed up and lost among the inward parts of some granitic beast. Deep stone flues where the water dripped and sang, tolling in the silence the minutes of the earth and the hours and the days of it and the years without cease, until they stood in a great stone room where lay a black and ancient lake, and on the far shore a creature that raised its dripping mouth from the rimstone pool and stared into the light with eyes dead white and sightless as the eggs of spiders. It swung its head low over the water as if to take the scent of what it couldn't see. Crouching there, pale and naked and translucent, its alabaster bones cast up in shadow on the rocks behind it, its bowels, its beating heart, the brain that pulsed in a dull glass bell. It swung its head from side to side and then gave out a low moan and turned and lurched away and loped soundlessly into the dark. With the first gray light, he rose and left the boy sleeping and walked out to the road and squatted and studied the country to the south, barren, silent, godless. He thought the month was October, but he wasn't sure. He hadn't kept a calendar for years. They were moving south. There'd be no surviving another winter here. When it was light enough to use the binoculars, he glassed the valley below, everything paling away into the murk, the soft ash blowing in loose swirls over the blacktop. He studied what he could see. The segments of road among the dead trees, looking for anything of color, any movement, any trace of standing smoke. He lowered the glasses and pulled down the cotton mask from his face and wiped his nose on the back of his wrist and then glassed the country again. Then he just sat there holding the binoculars and watching the ashen daylight congeal over the land. He knew only that the child was his warrant. He said, "If he's not the word of God, God never spoke." When he got back, the boy was still asleep. He pulled the blue plastic tarp off of him and folded it and carried it out to the grocery cart and packed it and came back with their plates and some cornmeal cakes in a plastic bag and a plastic bottle of syrup. He spread the small tarp they used for a table on the ground and laid everything out, and he took the pistol from his belt and laid it on the cloth. And then he just sat watching the boys sleep. He'd pulled away his mask in the night, and it was buried somewhere in the blankets. He watched the boy, and he looked out through the trees toward the road. This wasn't a safe place. They could be seen from the road now it was day. The boy turned in the blankets. Then he opened his eyes. "Hi, Papa," he said. "I'm right here."
"I know."
An hour later, they were on the road. He pushed the cart, and both he and the boy carried knapsacks. In the knapsacks were essential things, in case they had to abandon the cart and make a run for it. Clamped to the handle of the cart was a chrome motorcycle mirror that he used to watch the road behind them. He shifted the pack higher on his shoulders and looked out over the wasted country. The road was empty. Below in the little valley, the still gray serpentine of a river, motionless and precise. Along the shore, a burden of dead reeds. "You okay?" he said. The boy nodded. Then they set out along the black top in the gunmetal light, shuffling through the ash, each the other's world entire. They crossed the river by an old concrete bridge, and a few miles on, they came upon a roadside gas station. They stood in the road and studied it. "I think we should check it out," the man said. "Take a look." The weeds they forded fell to dust about them. They crossed the broken asphalt apron and found the tank for the pumps. The cap was gone, and the man dropped to his elbows to smell the pipe, but the odor of gas was only a rumor, faint and stale. He stood and looked over the building. The pumps, standing with their hoses, oddly still in place, the windows intact. The door to the service bay was open, and he went in. A standing metal toolbox against one wall. He went through the drawers, but there was nothing there that he could use. Good half-inch drive sockets, a ratchet. He stood looking around the garage. A metal barrel full of trash. He went into the office. Dust and ash everywhere. The boy stood in the door. A metal desk, a cash register, some old automotive manuals, swollen and sodden. The linoleum was stained and curling from the leaking roof. He crossed to the desk and stood there. Then he picked up the phone and dialed the number of his father's house in that long ago. The boy watched him.
"What are you doing?" he said.
A quarter mile down the road, he stopped and looked back.
"We're not thinking," he said. "We have to go back."
He pushed the cart off the road and tilted it over where it couldn't be seen, and they left their packs there and went back to the station. In the service bay, he dragged out the steel trash drum and tipped it over and pawed out all the quart plastic oil bottles. Then they sat in the floor decanting them of their dregs one by one, leaving the bottles to stand upside down, draining into a pan, until at the end they had almost a half quart of motor oil. He screwed down the plastic cap and wiped the bottle off with a rag and hefted it in his hand. Oil for their little slut lamp to light the long gray dusks, the long gray dawns.
"You can read me a story," the boy said. "Can't you, Papa?"
"Yes," he said. "I can."
On the far side of the river valley, the road passed through a stark black burn. Charred and limbless trunks of trees stretching away on every side, ash moving over the road and the sagging hands of blind wire strung from the blackened light poles whining thinly in the wind. A burned house in a clearing, and beyond that, a reach of meadowlands, stark and gray, and a raw red mud bank where a roadworks lay abandoned. Farther along were billboards advertising motels. Everything as it once had been, save faded and weathered. At the top of the hill, they stood in the cold and the wind getting their breath. He looked at the boy.
"I'm all right," the boy said.
The man put his hand on his shoulder and nodded toward the open country below them. Then he got the binoculars out of the cart and stood in the road and glassed the plain down there, where the shape of a city stood in the grayness like a charcoal sketch stretched across the waste. Nothing to see. No smoke.
Can I see? The boy said.
Yes. Of course you can.
The boy leaned on the cart and adjusted the wheel.
What do you see? The man said.
Nothing.
He lowered the glasses.
It's raining.
Yes, the man said. I know.
They left the cart in a gully covered with a tarp and made their way up the slope through the dark poles of the standing trees to where he'd seen a running ledge of rock, and they sat under the rock overhang and watched the gray sheets of rain blow across the valley. It was very cold. They sat huddled together, wrapped each in a blanket over their coats, and after a while the rain stopped and there was just the dripping in the woods. When it had cleared, they went down to the cart and pulled away the tarp and got their blankets and the things they'd need for the night. They went back up the hill and made their camp in the dry dirt under the rocks, and the man sat with his arms around the boy, trying to warm him. Wrapped in the blankets, watching the nameless dark come to enshroud them. The gray shape of the city vanished in the night's onset like an apparition, and he lit the little lamp and set it back out of the wind. Then they walked out to the road, and he took the boy's hand, and they went to the top of the hill where the road crested and where they could see out over the darkening country to the south, standing there in the wind, wrapped in their blankets, watching for any sign of a fire or a lamp. There was nothing. The lamp in the rocks on the side of the hill was little more than a mote of light, and after a while, they walked back. Everything too wet to make a fire. They ate their poor meal cold and lay down in their bedding with the lamp between them. He'd brought the boy's book, but the boy was too tired for reading.
"Can we leave the lamp on till I'm asleep?" he said.
"Yes, of course we can."
He was a long time going to sleep. After a while, he turned and looked at the man, his face in the small light streaked with black from the rain like some old-world thespian.
"Can I ask you something?" he said.
"Yes, of course."
"Are we going to die?"
"Sometime. Not now."
"And we're still going south?"
"Yes."
"So we'll be warm?"
"Yes."
"Okay."
"Okay what?"
"Nothing. Just okay."
"Go to sleep."
"Okay."
"I'm gonna blow out the lamp. Is that okay?"
"Yes, that's okay."
And then later in the darkness,
"Can I ask you something?"
"Yes, of course you can."
"What would you do if I died?"
"If you died, I'd want to die too."
"So you could be with me?"
"Yes, so I could be with you."
"Okay."
He lay listening to the water drip in the woods. Bedrock this, the cold and the silence. The ashes of the late world carried on the bleak and temporal winds to and fro in the void, carried forth and scattered and carried forth again. Everything uncoupled from its shoring, unsupported in the ashen air, sustained by a breath trembling and brief. If only my heart were stone. He woke before dawn and watched the gray day break, slow and half opaque. He rose while the boy slept and pulled on his shoes and wrapped in his blanket, he walked out through the trees. He descended into a grike in the stone, and there he crouched, coughing, and he coughed for a long time. Then he just knelt in the ashes. He raised his face to the paling day.
"Are you there?" he whispered. "Will I see you at last? Have you a neck by which to throttle you? Have you a heart? Damn you eternally. Have you a soul?" "Oh, God," he whispered. "Oh, God."
They passed through the city at noon of the day following. He kept the pistol to hand on the folded tarp on top of the cart. He kept the boy, close to his side. The city was mostly burned, no sign of life. Cars in the street caked with ash, everything covered with ash and dust. Fossil tracks in the dried sludge. A corpse in a doorway, dried to leather, grimacing at the day. He pulled the boy closer.
Just remember that the things you put into your head are there forever, he said. You might want to think about that.
You forget some things, don't you?
Yes. You forget what you want to remember, and you remember what you want to forget.
There was a lake a mile from his uncle's farm, where he and his uncle used to go in the fall for firewood. He sat in the back of the rowboat, trailing his hand in the cold wake, while his uncle bent to the oars. His feet in their black kid shoes braced against the uprights, his straw hat, his cob pipe in his teeth, and a thin drool swinging from the pipe bowl. He turned to take a sight on the far shore, cradling the oar handles, taking the pipe from his mouth to wipe his chin with the back of his hand. The shore was lined with birch trees that stood bone pale against the dark of the evergreens beyond. The edge of the lake was a rip-rap of twisted tree stumps, gray and weathered, the windfall trees of a hurricane years past. The trees themselves had long been sawed for firewood and carried away. His uncle turned the boat and shipped the oars, and they drifted over the sandy shallows until the transom grated in the sand. A dead perch lolling belly up in the clear water. Yellow leaves. They left their shoes on the warm painted boards and dragged the boat up onto the beach and set out the anchor at the end of its rope, a lard can poured with concrete with an eye bolt in the center. They walked along the shore while his uncle studied the tree stumps, puffing at his pipe, a manila rope coiled over his shoulder. He picked one out and they turned it over, using the roots for leverage, until they got it half floating in the water. Trousers rolled to the knee, but still they got wet. They tied the rope to a cleat at the rear of the boat and rowed back across the lake, jerking the stump slowly behind them. By then it was already evening, just the slow, periodic rack and shuffle of the oarlocks. The lake, dark glass and window lights coming on along the shore, a radio somewhere. Neither of them had spoken a word. This was the perfect day of his childhood. This the day to shape the days upon. They bore on south in the days and weeks to follow, solitary and dogged, a raw hill country, aluminum houses. At times, they could see stretches of the interstate highway below them through the bare stands of second-growth timber, cold and growing colder. Just beyond the high gap in the mountains, they stood and looked out over the great gulf to the south, where the country, as far as they could see, was burned away. The blackened shapes of rock standing out of the shoals of ash and billows of ash rising up and blowing down country through the waste. The track of the dull sun moving unseen beyond the murk. They were days fording that cauterized terrain. The boy had found some crayons and painted his face mask with tangs, and he trudged on uncomplaining. One of the front wheels of the cart had gone wonky. What to do about it? Nothing. Where all was burnt to ash before them, no fires were to be had, and the nights were long and dark and cold beyond anything they'd yet encountered. Cold to crack the stones, to take your life. He held the boy shivering against him and counted each frail breath in the blackness. He woke to the sound of distant thunder and sat up. The faint light all about, quivering and sourceless, refracted in the rain of drifting soot. He pulled the tarp about them, and he lay awake a long time listening. If they got wet, there'd be no fires to dry by. If they got wet, they would probably die. The blackness he woke to on those nights was sightless and impenetrable, and often he had to get up. No sound but the wind in the bare poles of the trees. He rose and stood tottering in that cold, autistic dark, with his arms outheld for balance, while the vestibular calculations in his skull cranked out their reckonings. An old chronicle, to seek out the upright. No fall but preceded by a declination. He took great marching steps into the nothingness, counting them against his return. Eyes closed, arms oaring. Upright to what? Something nameless in the night, load or matrix, to which he and the stars were common satellite, like the great pendulum in its rotunda scribing through the long day movements of the universe, of which you may say it knows nothing, and yet know it must. It took 2 days to cross the burn. The road beyond ran along the crest of a ridge where the barren woodland fell away on every side.
It's snowing,
the boy said. He looked at the sky. A single gray flake sifting down. He caught it in his hand and watched it expire there, like the last host of Christendom. They trundled along together with a tarp pulled over them, the wet gray flakes twisting and falling out of nothing. Gray slush by the roadside, black water running from under the sodden drifts of ash. No more bale fires on the distant ridges. He thought the blood cults must have all consumed themselves. No one traveled this road. No road agents, no marauders. After a while, they came to a roadside garage and they stood in the open door and looked out at the gray sleet gusting down out of the high country. They collected some old boxes and built a fire in the floor, and he found some tools and emptied out the cart and sat working on the wheel. He pulled the bolt and bored out the collet with a hand drill and re-sleeved it with a section of pipe he'd cut to length with a hacksaw. Then he bolted it all back together and stood the cart upright and wheeled it around the floor. It ran fairly true. The boy sat watching everything. In the morning, they went on. A desolate country, even before. A boar hide nailed to a barn door. Ratty. Wisp of a tail. Inside the barn, 3 bodies hanging from the rafters, dried and dusty among the wan slats of light.
There could be something here, the boy said. There could be some corn or something.
Let's go, the man said.
Mostly, he worried about their shoes. That and food. Always. In an old batboard smokehouse, they found a ham gambrelled up in a high corner. It looked like something fetched from a tomb, so dried and drawn. He cut into it with his knife. Deep, red, and salty meat inside. Rich and good. They fried it that night over their fire, thick slices of it, and put the slices to simmer with a tin of beans. Later he woke in the dark, and he thought that he'd heard bull drums beating somewhere in the low, dark hills. Then the wind shifted, and there was just the silence. In dreams, his pale bride came to him out of a green and leafy canopy, her nipples pipe-clayed and her rib bones painted white. She wore a dress of gauze, and her dark hair was carried up in combs of ivory, combs of shell. Her smile, her downturned eyes. In the morning, it was snowing again, beads of small gray ice strung along the light wires overhead. He mistrusted all of that. He said the right dreams for a man in peril were dreams of peril, and all else was the call of languor and of death. He slept little and he slept poorly. He dreamt of walking in a flowering wood where birds flew before them, he and the child, and the sky was aching blue. But he was learning how to wake himself from just such siren worlds. Lying awake in the dark with the uncanny taste of a peach from some phantom orchard fading in his mouth. He thought if he lived long enough, the world at last would all be lost. Like the dying world the newly blind inhabit, all of it slowly fading from memory. Daydreams on the road. There was no waking from them. He plodded on. He could remember everything of her, save her scent. Seated in a theater with her beside him, leaning forward, listening to the music. Gold scroll work and sconces and the tall columnar rolls of the drapes at either side of the stage. She held his hand in her lap, and he could feel the tops of her stockings through the thin stuff of her summer dress. Freeze this frame. Now, call down your dark and your cold and be damned. He fashioned sweeps from two old brooms he'd found and wired them to the cart to clear the limbs from the road in front of the wheels. And he put the boy in the basket and he stood on the rear rail like a dog musher and they set off down the hills, guiding the cart on the curves with their bodies in the manner of bobsledders. It was the first time he'd seen the boy smile in a long time. At the crest of the hill was a curve and a pull-out in the road, an old trail that led off through the woods. They walked out and sat on a bench and looked out over the valley where the land rolled away into the gritty fog. A lake down there, cold and gray and heavy in the scavenged bowl of the countryside.
What is it, Papa?
It's a dam.
What's it for?
It made the lake. Before they built the dam, that was just a river down there. The dam used the water that ran through it to turn big fans called turbines that would generate electricity.
To make lights?
Yes, to make lights.
Can we go down there and see it?
I think it's too far.
Will the dam be there for a long time?
I think so. It's made out of concrete. It'll probably be there for hundreds of years, thousands even.
Do you think there could be fish in the lake?
No. There's nothing in the lake.
In that long ago, somewhere very near this place, he'd watched a falcon fall down the long blue wall of the mountain and break with the keel of its breastbone the midmost from a flight of cranes and take it to the river below, all gangly and wrecked and trailing its loose and blousy plumage in the still air. The grainy air. The taste of it never left your mouth. They went on, holding the tarp over them in the dull drizzle. Their feet were wet and cold, and their shoes were being ruined. On the hillsides, old crops dead and flattened, the barren ridgeline trees raw and black in the rain. And the dreams, so rich in color. How else would death call you? Waking in the cold dawn, it all turned to ash instantly, like certain ancient frescoes entombed for centuries suddenly exposed to the day. The weather lifted, and the cold, and they came at last into the broad lowland river valley, the pierced farmland still visible, everything dead to the root along the barren bottomlands. They trucked on along the blacktop, tall clabbered houses, machine-rolled metal roofs, a log barn in a field with an advertisement in faded 10-foot letters across the roof slope, See Rock City. The roadside hedges were gone to rows of black and twisted brambles, no sign of life. He left the boy standing in the road holding the pistol while he climbed an old set of limestone steps and walked along the porch of the farmhouse, shading his eyes and peering in the windows. He let himself in through the kitchen. Trash in the floor, old newsprint, china in a break front, cups hanging from their hooks. He went down the hallway and stood in the door to the parlor. There was an antique pump organ in the corner, a television set. Cheap stuffed furniture together with an old handmade cherrywood chiffer robe. He climbed the stairs and walked through the bedrooms, everything covered with ash. A child's room with a stuffed dog on the windowsill, looking out at the garden.
He went through the closets. He stripped back the beds and came away with two good woolen blankets and went back down the stairs. In the pantry were three jars of home-canned tomatoes. He blew the dust from the lids and studied them. Someone before him hadn't trusted them, and in the end, neither did he. And he walked out with the blankets over his shoulder, and they set off along the road again. On the outskirts of the city, they came to a supermarket, a few old cars in the trash-strewn parking lot. They left the cart in the lot and walked the littered aisles. In the produce section at the bottom of the bins, they found a few ancient runner beans and what looked to have once been apricots, long dried to wrinkled effigies of themselves. The boy followed behind. They pushed out through the rear door. In the alleyway behind the store, a few shopping carts, all badly rusted. They went back through the store again, looking for another cart, but there were none. By the door were two soft drink machines that had been tilted over into the floor and opened with a pry bar. Coins everywhere in the ash. He sat and ran his hand around in the works of the gutted machines, and in the second one, it closed over a cold metal cylinder. He withdrew his hand slowly and sat looking at a Coca-Cola.
"What is it, Papa?"
"It's a treat for you."
"What is it?"
"Here, sit down." He slipped the boy's knapsack straps loose and set the pack on the floor behind him, and he put his thumbnail under the aluminum clip on the top of the can and opened it. He leaned his nose to the slight fizz coming from the can and then handed it to the boy. "Go ahead," he said. The boy took the can.
"It's bubbly," he said.
"Go ahead." He looked at his father and then tilted the can and drank. He sat there thinking about it.
"It's really good," he said.
"Yes, it is."
"You have some, Papa."
"I want you to drink it."
"You have some."
He took the can and sipped it and handed it back. "You drink it," he said. "Let's just sit here."
"It's because I won't ever get to drink another one, isn't it?"
"Ever's a long time."
"Okay,"
the boy said. By dusk of the day following, they were at the city. The long concrete sweeps of the interstate exchanges like the ruins of a vast funhouse against the distant murk. He carried the revolver in his belt at the front and wore his parka unzipped. The mummied dead everywhere. The flesh cloven along the bones, the ligaments dried to tug and taut as wires. Shriveled and drawn like latter-day bog folk, their faces of boiled sheeting, the yellowed palings of their teeth. They were discalced to a man, like pilgrims of some common order, for all their shoes were long since stolen. They went on. He kept a constant watch behind him in the mirror. The only thing that moved in the streets was the blowing ash. They crossed the high concrete bridge over the river, a dock below, small pleasure boats half sunken in the gray water, tall stacks downriver, dim in the soot. The day following, some few miles south of the city, at a bend in the road and half lost in the dead brambles, they came upon an old frame house with chimneys and gables and a stone wall. The man stopped. Then he pushed the cart up the drive.
"What's this place, Papa?"
"It's the house where I grew up." The boy stood looking at it. The peeling wooden clapboards were largely gone from the lower walls for firewood, leaving the studs and the insulation exposed. The rotted screening from the back porch lay on the concrete terrace.
"Are we going in?"
"Why not?"
"I'm scared."
"Don't you want to see where I used to live?"
"No."
"It'll be okay."
"There could be somebody here."
"I don't think so."
"But suppose there is?"
He stood looking up at the gable to his old room. He looked at the boy. "Do you want to wait here?"
"No, you always say that."
"I'm sorry."
I know, but you do.
They slipped out of their backpacks and left them on the terrace and kicked their way through the trash on the porch and pushed into the kitchen. The boy held on to his hand. All much as he'd remembered it. The rooms empty. In the small room off the dining room, there was a bare iron cot, a metal folding table. The same cast iron coal grate in the small fireplace. The pine paneling was gone from the walls, leaving just the furring strips. He stood there. He felt with his thumb in the painted wood of the mantel, the pinholes from tacks that had held stockings 40 years ago. "This is where we used to have Christmas when I was a boy," he said. He turned and looked out at the waste of the yard, a tangle of dead lilac, the shape of a hedge. On cold winter nights, when the electricity was out in a storm, we'd sit at the fire here, me and my sisters, doing our homework. The boy watched him, watched shapes claiming him he couldn't see. "We should go, Papa," he said. "Yes," the man said, but he didn't. They walked through the dining room, where the fire brick in the hearth was as yellow as the day it was laid, because his mother couldn't bear to see it blackened. The floor buckled from the rainwater. In the living room, the bones of a small animal dismembered and placed in a pile, possibly a cat, a glass tumbler by the door. The boy gripped his hand. They went up the stairs and turned and went down the hallway, small cones of damp plaster standing in the floor, the wooden laths of the ceiling exposed. He stood in the doorway to his room, a small space under the eaves. "This is where I used to sleep," he said. "My cot was against this wall. In the nights, in their thousands, to dream the dreams of a child's imaginings, worlds, rich or fearful, such as might offer themselves, but never the one to be." He pushed open the closet door, half expecting to find his childhood things. Raw, cold daylight fell through from the roof, gray as his heart.
"We should go, Papa. Can we go?"
"Yes, we can go."
"I'm scared."
"I know. I'm sorry."
"I'm really scared."
"It's all right. We shouldn't have come."
3 nights later, in the foothills of the eastern mountains, he woke in the darkness to hear something coming. He lay his hands at either side of him. The ground was trembling. It was coming toward them.
"Papa," the boy said. "Papa."
"Shh, it's okay."
"What is it, Papa?"
It neared, growing louder, everything trembling. Then it passed beneath them like an underground train and drew away into the night and was gone. The boy clung to him, crying, his head buried against his chest.
"Shh, it's all right."
"I'm so scared."
"I know. It's all right. It's gone."
"What was it, Papa?"
"It was an earthquake. It's gone now. We're all right.
Shh."
In those first years, the roads were peopled with refugees, shrouded up in their clothing, wearing masks and goggles, sitting in their rags by the side of the road like ruined aviators, their barrels heaped with shoddy, towing wagons or carts, their eyes bright in their skulls, creedless shells of men tottering down the causeways like migrants in a fever land, the frailty of everything revealed at last, old and troubling issues resolved into nothingness and night. The last instance of a thing takes the class with it, turns out the light, and is gone. Look around you. Ever is a long time. But the boy knew what he knew, that ever is no time at all. He sat by a gray window in the gray light of an abandoned house in the late afternoon and read old newspapers while the boy slept, the curious news, the quaint concerns. At 8, the primrose closes. He watched the boy sleeping. Can you do it when the time comes? Can you? They squatted in the road and ate cold rice and cold beans that they'd cooked days ago, already beginning to ferment. No place to make a fire that wouldn't be seen. They slept huddled together in the rank quilts in the dark and the cold. He held the boy close to him, so thin. My heart, he said. My heart. But he knew that if he were a good father, it might well be as she had said, that the boy was all that stood between him and death. Late in the year, he hardly knew the month. He thought they had enough food to get through the mountains, but there was no way to tell. The pass at the watershed was 5,000 feet, and it was going to be very cold. He said that everything depended on reaching the coast. Yet waking in the night, he knew that all of this was empty and no substance to it. There was a good chance they'd die in the mountains, and that would be that. They passed through the ruins of a resort town and took the road south. Burnt forests for miles along the slopes and snow sooner than he would have thought. No tracks in the road, nothing living anywhere. The fire blackened boulders like the shapes of bears on the starkly wooded slopes. He stood on a stone bridge where the water slurried into a pool and turned slowly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.